Okay. Morning, everybody, and welcome to the Equal Opportunities Committee. It's the 15th meeting of 2015. Can I ask you to set any electronic devices to flight mode or off, please? I'd like to start with introductions. We're supported at the table by the clerk and research staff, official reporter and broadcasting services, and around the room by the security office, and welcome also to observers in the public gallery. My name is Margaret McCulloch and I'm the committee's convener. Members will now introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right.
Morning, it's Sandra White, MSP for Glasgow Kelvin and Deputy Convener.
Good morning, Christian Allard, MSP for the North East of Scotland.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Drew Smith, Member for Glasgow.
Annabel Gould, the MSP for the West of Scotland.
Morning, John Finney, MSP Highlands and Islands.
Thank you. Today we have one agenda item, an evidence session on removing barriers, race, ethnicity and employment inquiry. If witnesses or members wish to speak during the discussion, can you please indicate to either myself or my clerk on my left-hand side? I welcome the panel and ask witnesses to introduce themselves. Can I also invite witnesses to briefly outline the work of their organisation and any current projects for the members, please? And we'll start with Helen. You're fine. It's okay. It comes on automatically.
Oh, does it come on? Okay. Never mind. I'm Helen Martin from the STUC, and I'm secretary to the STUC's Black Workers Committee. The Black Workers Committee brings together black workers from all across Scotland, from a range of organisations and a range of sectors. And it's a sort of self-organising committee that passes policy each year, and it really helps the STUC understand the needs of black workers and make sure that our policy reflects their views of the society and of the labour market as well. I think we've got a whole variety of work that we're undertaking at the minute, but I think the committee would be particularly interested in the fact that we're currently being funded from the Fair Work Directorate to do a pilot project looking at the creation of equality reps within the private and third sectors. And this is a kind of new piece of work that we're looking at, how it is that you support equality reps in those industries, particularly given the fact that there's no statutory recognition of the equality rep status. The idea is that the pilot project will select four workplaces and will try to support the creation or the development of equality reps, and that's ongoing until April.
Thank you. Katie?
I'm Katie Hutton from Skills Development Scotland. I've got responsibility for the National Training Programmes, Modern Apprenticeships and Employability Fund. We're doing a range of activity in terms of equality of opportunity. I suppose the kind of three main areas I'd like to highlight are, first of all, engagement with individuals and parents among ethnically diverse communities. We've got a project with Bemis at the moment called Modern Apprenticeships for All, which is two full-time members of staff embedded with Bemis, working with a range of community groups to go out there and basically sell both to parents and individuals the benefits of undertaking a modern apprenticeship as a career. We've got a range of challenge projects with community groups too, to look at diverse ways of engaging individuals in modern apprenticeships as well. Our CIAG services as well, careers information, advice and guidance, we've got a range of measures in place to reach ethnically diverse communities, and we've got continuous professional development for our own staff and toolkits to support individuals in giving guidance to ethnically diverse communities in terms of understanding customs, cultural norms, etc. And then lastly, in terms of continuous improvement of our services, we've got an equality advisory group that we use a lot to advise and guide us on how we might tailor our services to different groups. And that would be looking at things like our online guidance tool, My World of Work, working with communities to look at how the information is presented, how we might better present the information going forward. So that's just a snapshot of things that we're doing.
Thank you, David.
Morning, I'm David Watt from Education Scotland, Senior Education Officer with responsibility for inclusion and equalities. Within Education Scotland, we have a range of work streams taken forward, developing young workforce and working together with Skills Development Scotland to publish career education standards and work placement standards imminently within the next couple of weeks. I'd just maybe like to mention the success in Scottish schools in attainment of children from ethnic minorities, and most of the ethnic minorities, if not all, are attaining above national averages. A strong success for our schools and education authorities. And even those young people who have additional support for learning are now achieving ahead of national averages. They are gaining entry to higher education and further education above national averages. Still a bit of work to do in terms of employment. That's below a national average for those with ethnic minorities. But we're working from a strong base to continue to improve outcomes.
John.
Yeah. CIPD Scotland, we are the body for professional people in development. We represent in Scotland 10,000 members, UK-wide and increasingly internationally, a total, including the Scottish total, of 140,000. We're at the forefront of inclusion in the labour market, working across all sorts of agendas, from developing young people, developing people with disabilities, etc., and making work access to opportunities available to all. Obviously, you know, there's a lot of work to be done on the BME agenda, and we acknowledge that. We acknowledge that there's a long way to go before we have a good evidence base for what good practice should look like. But we're happy to work with the parties in Scotland and nationally.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I just say, when you actually go to speak, you don't have to press the buzzer. It'll come on automatically, okay? Katie, can I ask you first sort of specific questions about Skills Development Scotland? You mentioned about BMIS and the other projects you're actually doing. Can you expand a bit more about what the two allocated individuals, their actual role actually is within BMIS and what sort of outcome you're actually expecting from that?
Yes. A range of community groups have told us it's about engagement. It's about going out there and reaching out to the community who may not have a great deal of awareness about what modern apprenticeship's about. And crucially, what they've told us is that it's about selling a career rather than just an opportunity at that point post-school. And as you'll be aware, higher education in particular is a favoured route among some groups. So these individuals are going round various community groups, and it's really... it's really shoe leather, going out, going round across Scotland. So far already, I've seen in terms of the reports we're getting back, there's about 158 groups already where there's events lined up to talk about modern apprenticeships and the Employability Fund. It's things like also CV building, etc., that sort of thing. Going round, they've got hard outcomes in terms of we want 200 additional individuals from BME background participating in modern apprenticeships next year. So we've given them hard outcomes, but a lot of it is about going out there to different groups, using taking advantage of events that are already on the ground and also setting things up themselves.
What kind of feedback are they getting when they're speaking to the groups about the reasons why they don't participate in the modern apprenticeship programme?
I think it's back to what I said in terms of the career route. They yeah. want to understand more about the career that they'll get. Someone said to me last week it's about a lot of BME community groups are prepared to sacrifice now in terms of putting individuals through HE, etc., for the benefits of long-term career. And I think it is about that thing about, well, you know, what does that get me in the future? So that's the kind of messages that the two individuals who are working with BMIS are going out there to promulgate.
Yeah, okay. And the other sort of question is employers that are recruiting apprentices. What are you actually doing along those lines to encourage employers to open up their sort of recruitment process to more ethnic groups as well?
Okay. I mean, you know, one of the issues about modern apprenticeships is it's the employer who, by and large, makes the recruitment decision. Unless the training provider is asked specifically to undertake the recruitment process, it's mostly the employer. So we are doing the usual in terms of trying to promote the business benefits of diversity within the workforce. We've got an equality toolkit online on our Skills Force, which is our online service for employers as well. And we're looking at what we can do around unconscious bias advice as well. The training providers, and that includes colleges, local authorities, private training providers, third sector organisations, they're really the sales force to employers. Mm-hmm. So we've invested quite a lot in terms of what we do with them. So the Qualities Challenge Unit, for instance, undertook on our behalf the end of last year a training needs analysis for us in terms of understanding issues around diversity. And before that, we'd funded also some CPD. We had about 8 events and 4 webinars around equality of opportunity with training providers. And we will be building on that on the basis of the training needs analysis of employers doing there. We've held Get Connected events. The other thing that we've done is we're funding Challenge Fund projects, and about 7 out of I think the 14 are actually have a BME theme as part of them. The other thing that we're looking at, which is a kind of quite a delicate issue, is around the whole procurement issue with employers. So we've been speaking and working on a project with Scottish Government and actually the police on with the Equality and Human Rights Commission about what you can put in your procurement requirements around equality of opportunity. And we're adding some things to it for 16-17 contracting along the best practice guidelines from the EHRC. But what we also want to do is talk to employer groups. CIPD might actually be an interesting one there, business organisations, around what more could we do in terms of reaching it, getting the message across to employers, and also what you can put within your procurement guidelines beyond 16-17. Okay. And also things like our own staff. We've got a small employer engagement team, so they've been through qualities training, and it's about selling the messages there too. So that's a range of things that we're doing.
I think Annabelle wants to come in.
Quick factual questions. For Katie, how does Skills Development Scotland measure participation by ethnic minority young people in modern apprenticeships or other training schemes? And once they're in, does Skills Development Scotland carry out any appraisal or review of how they're getting on?
Okay, in terms of the measurement, what we do is measure the number of starts or the percentage of starts, people who've started in a modern apprenticeship. So that's the measurement. That start, I have to say, is a self-reported start. So you ask the individual when you're going through the registration for them, when they're sitting in the when they've been recruited in the company, or if the company has chosen them amongst their existing workforce, and you ask them what their ethnic group is, but it's a self-reported basis. And we do get some people refusing to say what their ethnic background is. In terms of what we offer once they're on a modern apprenticeship, that's really what the training provider in tandem with the employer should do, because they are an employee of the company. So it's really about what's provided as part of their training and assessment. What our staff do is we go out and speak to the contracted training providers and talk to them about what they're providing. We also will speak to trainees and employers as part of it to say, look, are you happy with the training that you're doing?
And just to be clear, Convener, does that include discussing with the apprentice?
Yes, we do a sample of
how they're getting on.
Yes, we speak to a sample of all the modern apprentices who are involved in the programme and ask them, what do you think about the quality of your induction? What do you think about the training that you're getting? Are you happy with the support you're getting for your employers? So that's what our contract managers do. And also we will do in-training surveys as well online from time to time too.
Thank you very much, Camilla.
Can I just come in on that? And I know you're talking about surveys as well. When every modern apprentice completes a programme, you send out surveys as well, or leaves the programme, do you?
We do. Every few years we do a leaver survey to find out actually what happened to them 6 months plus being an apprentice.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we do.
Yeah, okay. I'm probably going to go back and ask you to probably expand a wee bit, given the younger age profile from the ethnic minority population in Scotland. What are the other reasons that are actually stopping young people from participating in the modern apprenticeship programme? I know you say maybe
lack of knowledge about the modern apprenticeship programme in general. Is there other cultural reasons that's barriers? Or, I mean, I know some people think modern apprenticeships aren't as good as maybe going into college or university, higher education, but I probably declare an interest in that I was involved in the modern apprenticeship programme, and there is opportunities for young people doing the modern apprentice to go on and do degrees as well and carry on their education within a working environment. But what other barriers are you hearing from young people?
I mean, I think part of it is, I mean, 80% of school leavers in the school leaver destination report from a BME background go on to FE and HE. So therefore already, and that's compared to 65% from other backgrounds, so there is a choice being made, and it's can be a family choice as well about what you want, culturally, that's where the route that you take. So already, I think, in terms of looking at the young age groups that you were asking about specifically, you can see the choice being made to go there. I think there'd be other things about, you know, the community doesn't necessarily have the links to the workplace, perhaps, as other, you know, if you've not got those links, perhaps you come here as a refugee, whatever, you've not got the links to employers, and your family's not got links to them as well. So there can be a variety. You can be isolated as a community too, in terms of what you've got. And again, just if no one's ever gone into construction in your family, or maybe you've heard perhaps within certain industries that, you know, they don't take people who come from our background, that may be part of the kind of you know, the dialogue within the community, then again, there are a variety of reasons why you could be put off taking particular paths. But obviously, if you're, you know, if your parents are very keen for you to become a doctor or a lawyer, then you'll go down that route post-school.
Thank you. Helen, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, I think really I'd like to agree with a lot of what Katie is saying. I think there is sort of a perception among ethnic minority communities that higher education is really the way to go. But I think that we can't give up on the idea that apprenticeships are actually a really good route for ethnic minority young people. And, you know, it goes back to the Wood Commission and the Parity of Esteem agenda that we're trying to create. And one of the barriers that ethnic minority young people face later, even when they come out with degrees, is that they find it difficult to get into employment roles that other people maybe do get into, because they don't have the same opportunities to do on-paid internships and other sorts of things that often are the routes into good careers at the minute in our labour market. And the reason why that's harder for an ethnic minority young person is that they don't have the social capital that come with a lot of other families. So they don't necessarily know people who work within industries. So actually the apprenticeship route is a really good route for ethnic minority young people, because it helps build that social capital. It takes you into the workplace earlier, and it gives you a very structured route into work, which could actually help with the longer term labour market outcomes that we are ultimately trying to change. And I'd just like to say, on the foundation apprenticeship scheme, which is the kind of new scheme that's being developed at the minute, the foundation apprenticeships differ very substantially from normal apprenticeships, as I'm sure the committee is aware, because they are not employed. They are unpaid, and they're a sort of form of work experience, as it were. And obviously the STC would have some concerns about that as an approach, but given that that's the route we've decided to take, I think it's incumbent on us to make sure that we are making the most of that route, because given that they're not employees, you would be able to do a lot more sort of positive action targeting towards BME young people than you would be able to do when there is the employed status involved. So we would hope that the foundation apprenticeship will be used as a way to sort of break down the occupational segregation that we've seen within apprenticeships in the past.
Katie, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, and just in case the committee isn't aware, foundation apprenticeships are within the school system, so it's an option you can take when you're in fourth year. And they're just developing at the moment. We've got two pathfinders on at the moment, and there'll be more next year and more the following year. And the work experience part of it, and the whole ethos behind it, is that will create parity of esteem, basically, in terms of the work-based learning route. And you'll come out with a nationally recognised qualification that means that you've already done part of your apprenticeship too, which is a good thing. And work experience can take many forms, which I think is, you know, we talked about this actually at our Equalities Advisory Group on Friday about the whole issue about paid work experience. It can take many forms in terms of it could be an afternoon in the workplace, etc. So there are some issues around that, but it is a developing it's a developing option, and we hope, particularly as Helen says around the Equalities Agenda, we've got high hopes about that right from school place, it having parity esteem with other academic qualifications and actually picking up people earlier to go down the work-based learning route.
Okay, thank you. John?
Yeah, for that, I think you mentioned with Hutton, 200 at one stage was a figure. I wonder if you just explain what that was. Was that to be an increase?
That's to be 200 individuals from BMA background taking up modern apprenticeships and work-based learning employed route as a result of the activities that BMIS are undertaking, yes.
So is that 200 there for, on top of how many are presently doing it?
Yes.
And where would that take us to?
That would take us to, we had, at the end of 14-15, we had 361 individuals self-declaring from a BME background. But that's not the only, I mean, that's one, BMIS is one activity. We've got challenge fund projects, yes. Rathbone, for instance, last year.
Yeah, it's the numbers I'm interested
right,
in,
okay, so.
Being a kind of numbers person. Mm-hmm. Because if I'm right in saying we're talking, is it 25,000 modern apprenticeships?
Yes. Uh-huh.
So 1% would be 250.
Yep.
And given that 4%, I think, is the average across, so yeah. We should be at 1,000.
Yes.
If it was to be proportional. Uh-huh. And amongst young people, it might even be higher.
Well, that's the working age population for 16 to 24 we're looking at, because remember right. The 25 plus age group is targeted at certain sectors, so it's not necessarily representative of the whole workplace. So we're specifically looking at 16 to 24 as a key group.
Right, and that's more than 4% then for
that's
Scotland?
Well, it's 4.4%.
4.4, okay,
yeah.
Fair
so that, you're right, we're looking at an additional 700 individuals from BME right. background.
So would the hope be to get it up to 1,000? Is that what we're aiming at?
The hope would be for it to be reflective of the working age population, BME groups.
Okay,
yeah.
Thanks. Sure.
Very briefly before Christian comes in, is there anything you can do to try and capture the other ethnic individuals that don't want to actually tick the box to say that they come from that background? Because there could be a rough higher percentage of people in the workplace doing modern apprentices yeah. that aren't sort of identifying themselves.
Yes, so at the moment the Equalities Challenge Unit are working with us on two things, definitional issues, but also one about what are the best strategies we've got to enable people to self-declare across a range of equalities issues. We know, for instance, that graduates who've got a disability, even graduates are not keen on declaring some aspects about themselves. So at the moment, that's about looking at the best strategies, good practice around enabling individuals to declare, and then what we would do, again, is you know, speak to our training providers about that, have good practice sessions around that, about helping individuals.
Okay, thank you. Christian?
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm struggling a little bit, and I would like some clarification. You know, I know John talked about numbers, and numbers are very important, but it's about people. You know, BMIS is doing a fantastic work, and you're doing a great work, and it seems to be working. But because you said early on that one of the biggest difficulties that you have is families from a different ethnic background are really very successful and higher education, and they are willing for their children to be doctors and solicitors and etc. Are we targeting really best people to go into modern apprenticeship? Are we talking to families, to asking them to consider their son and daughter to become bricklayers as opposed to doctors or solicitors? Are we doing this?
Helen, sorry, David, because I know you were waiting to come in. And then Helen.
Together with Skills Development Scotland, at early stages within secondary school, we are making an enhanced offer that when they're making subject choices, they will have a number of group sessions plus an individual session together with a parent to discuss career options and to look at subject choices. I think there's another bit of work that schools are taking forward just now within the senior phase about more personalised pathways and better working between school and business to offer a senior phase that leads them to the world of work. That's still ongoing development work at senior phases, but there's some exciting stuff happening within schools across Scotland to broaden people's choices, which I think is one of the things underpinning this, that people need to have higher expectations for themselves.
My concern, Mr. Watt, is that we are targeting that diversification to a specific group. Are we going to ask Dr. McLeod to tell him that his children shouldn't become doctors, but we should go into masonry? It's what I'm asking.
What you're doing is you're laying out the options. You're making sure that it's informed choices, so it's not uninformed in terms of the work-based learning route. You're not forcing people to choose the apprenticeship route. It's about making informed choices.
I agree. But we seem to be spending money and a lot of effort for a specific ethnic minority to go from higher education to modern apprenticeship. That would be, you know, not very equal if we're doing that only to one part of the population. I found it difficult.
It's not just one part of the population. I mean, we do promotion across Scotland in terms of apprenticeships. We recognise, in terms of looking at the statistics around modern apprenticeships, that there are some communities that aren't taking up, that aren't going straight into the workplace and taking up apprenticeships. I think what we've got to demonstrate is that we are helping individuals to make informed choices. It's up to an individual whether they become a doctor or not, but we have to make sure that the message gets out there.
Helen. Yeah, I think it's important that we don't think in caricatures about, you know, what part of education is better for young people. And I think it's right that ethnic minority young people should have the same ability to access modern apprenticeships as all other parts of the population, because it is the case that a lot of ethnic minority young people are going on to higher education at the minute, but that doesn't mean that that's right for that ethnic minority young person. It might be that they would actually do much better if they were given the option of doing an apprenticeship, because they potentially learn in a different way. And it's not necessarily the case that just because you've done higher education that means that you're going to have an excellent labour market outcome. Like, we know that there are an awful lot of ethnic minority young people who do higher education, get a good degree, and then don't have the good labour market outcomes that you would expect from that degree because of other injustices within the labour market. And I also think it's important that we remember that there are some really good professions that you can access through modern apprenticeships that would allow you to potentially become a doctor, but in a different way and in a different route, or allow you to become a pharmacist in a different way and in a different route, or an engineer or whatever, and that those options might actually be the best route for that young person because they might prefer that style of learning. But right now we're seeing in a lot of ways in our education sector people being funneled by their background, by the level of earnings that their parents have or in lots of other ways into specific routes. And I think that that's really negative for all young people, actually, whether they end up in higher education or in apprenticeships, because people should be given the ability to choose what's best for them as a learner, not what's best for them due to their ethnic background or the earnings of their parents.
My last concern about it, and if you want to answer it, is how we are targeting people under the ethnicity and try to pigeonhole them in different areas, modern apprenticeship or higher education, just to satisfy some arbitrary numbers that some people should be, they should be equality about education experience.
Can I bring David in this just now?
Yeah, I mean, I just want to rephrase it in terms of a more personalised approach for people. And in terms of our where we sit with Scottish education, we've probably had an unheralded success with engaging with those with ethnic minorities and ensuring that they make their attainment and that measure of attainment successfully. But I think the next area is aligned to what you're talking about, is we need to be a bit more focused around the underachievement of boys compared to girls. We need to be aware across ethnic minorities that Asian girls, for instance, do very well, but we know Gypsy Travellers, don't reach the scores, never mind make an improvement. And so I think we have to look at these in a personalised way to ensure that young people are making those choices within their senior phase that are going to lead to the best option for them in terms of whether, we've moved away from an academic vocational divide and moved into looking at pathways and achievement pathways for young people.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to Sandra.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've talked obviously a lot about apprenticeships and modern apprenticeships, and there's lots and lots of work going on out there from everyone, but we don't seem to have a lot of data in regards to exactly what BME factions go into, what type of modern apprenticeship, taking it through the course, if there's a high dropout rate, if they actually get there at the end. I think it was Mr. McGurk that mentioned the fact about being evidence-based, but we don't seem to have a lot of data in regards to that. Can any of you tell me exactly what you're doing to follow that pathway through? I think that's a favourite word that's came out, pathway, lately, because basically we don't seem to be able to have the data to let us know exactly what's happening with BME youth kids when they go into, or if they even do go into apprenticeships, and what type of apprenticeship they actually go into.
Katie? We do have data. We publish quarterly statistics, I think, on starts. And I think we've now started doing it on achievement rates as well, but we certainly do it on an annual basis. We're developing an Equalities Action Plan right now, which is in response to the Developing Young Workforce Commission, Youth Employment Strategy, and on it, one of the actions we've got, without giving anything away, is about the data side of it, which is, you know, working with representative groups to see what kind of data they want to see. We do collect data. We collect it on achievement, we collect it on start, we collect it on gender, ethnicity. You know, we have data that, and we publish actually quite a lot of data on a quarterly basis, but if there's more that that groups would like to see, then we're happy to talk and publish that. Sometimes you only hear about what people want through the medium of a committee, actually, which is interesting, but certainly, we've got that as one of the actions to look at what more that we have to get out there.
Well, certainly, you mentioned about evidence, the committee. The evidence we've taken so far says that, and SGC gave evidence also, that we don't have the data in BME communities going forward in ethnic minorities for apprenticeships. And I just wonder how that would affect, like, so Mr. McGurk's profession, if the data is there. Do you receive data of that type?
I think employers collect data routinely on recruitment, on training, promotion, you know, and various work cycle issues like performance management, grievances, dismissal, organisational exit, etc. And, you know, generally it's good practice to monitor by specific groups, but it's wickedly difficult to collect that data systematically and actually use it. And we would acknowledge that there needs to be much more of a mindset around business about how you use that data purposefully, because what happens when you don't use it purposefully is people just collect it and then forget about it. So you need to use it to create a dialogue about the problem and try and solve it. And obviously, you know, there are organisations that are very good at that, like the big public sector bodies tend to be pretty good at collecting that kind of data. They have obligations to do it. But if you're talking about a large number, for example, we had a launch with the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work Skills and Training yesterday, a people skills programme to support SME capability and people in development. And, you know, it's quite clear the number of SMEs in Scotland. How do you collect the data in that area where a lot of the opportunities exist? And we're not, you know, we're saying that, yes, it absolutely has to be an evidence-based approach, but there are a huge number of gaps before we actually get to having that evidence. But a real start would be to collect the data purposefully so that we could compare it and start to make decisions.
Sorry to come back in. If you do have the data, we'd really like to see it. But basically, from the information that we've received, if there is any data there, it doesn't say about the ethnicity of the people who are taking part in modern apprenticeships. So therefore, it's not broken down enough for us to be, or for anyone.
We can do that if people want to see that published.
You don't do that at the moment.
We publish a lot of data. I have to say, ME statistics are a lot out there, more than a lot of other public sector agencies. We publish quarterly statistics. On that, we could publish one thing you've got to watch about when you're publishing data. It seems like it's down to very small numbers. Sometimes you're not allowed to publish that because you could actually identify the individual. So there's rules around that. But certainly we can look at what we publish. And as I say, it's on our action plan to do that, to talk to partners about what they'd like to see us publishing. So we'll do that.
Yeah, just to hammer home this point, or going about it once again, the reason we're doing this inquiry is because of the BME communities, and lots of work has been done out there, and I congratulate everyone who's doing that work. But we don't have the actual data to tell us, particularly in the modern apprenticeship situation, exactly what BME communities are taking part in apprenticeships, what the dropout rate is, and what the flow through is at the end. And that's what we're looking for, because as you all said yourself, that BME communities are doing so well, educationally wise, but the figures and the data that you do publish shows that an awful lot of them are not able to get employment at the end up. So we would just like to know a wee bit, you know, more about BME communities, and if they are actually enabling them to, if you're enabling them to get through into modern apprenticeships, and if you follow that through.
Talking about subdividing the BME groups by the census groups, are you talking about that?
That would be a help.
Okay.
Something like that.
Can I just sort of summarise and clarify that we're looking for ME starts, leavers, and the ethnic group that actually come from, if they've achieved an ME, and probably the dropout rate as well.
So at the moment we publish, for BME in general, the start, leaver, and achievement rate. That's what we publish already. So what you're talking about is, so again, with the caveat that if we get down to very small numbers and groups, then you really can't show that.
And also if they're still in a job when they complete their ME qualification as well.
If
they're still in a job when they complete their ME qualification.
One of the issues about that is that we do that through survey, because you can't do a census of, you know, however many thousands leave every year. If you do it by survey, then you're getting into sample sizes. There's an issue there. I mean, we can look at that as part of our research. A big part of our research is to look at the equalities agenda too going forward. So you just need to watch in terms of sample size.
Yep, that's fine. Thank you. Very briefly, Christian.
COVID, I just want to clarify something. I hear two things. We, as a committee, we're asking for data, but are you saying that if we do the subdividing of different ethnic, that data won't tell us anything?
Saying is, with official public, you know, official statistics guidelines, if you subdivide by a group and it gets down to like one or two people in that group, then you're really not supposed to publish it, because they could be identified as an individual. So sometimes you've got issues about small numbers.
But, so what are we asking? Is it not possible? Is what you're asking?
No, it's possible to break it down. What I'm saying is, for some groups, we just need to be careful about, you know, you could say what their name is, you know, where they live.
Thank you.
We touched on this when we talked about young people specifically, but I'm going to be interested to hear a little bit more, maybe particularly from Education Scotland and from SDS, about what schools are actually doing to encourage people from ethnic minority backgrounds into training or apprenticeship programmes. Is there specific work that is targeted at these groups of people, or?
It's not targeted at present. We're introducing some career education standards and work placement guidance that is going to be framed in terms of equalities and taking account of the public sector duties specifically within this area. I think the schools and SDS have had the focus on ensuring that their qualifications gain them access to FE and HE. I think the question that is now to be raised with schools about yes, we have been successful in raising the attainment, but you now need to engage with parents and young people around choices directly from school. That's maybe an area we continually need to work on.
Could I make a point? I think that, you know, apprenticeship and access to modern apprenticeship is absolutely vital, but we have to have a wider debate about the skills and labour market issue. And in CIPD Scotland, we put forward an approach called Scotland Skilled Future, where we look at everything from preschool, which is important. You know, you need to look at how people actually get socialised and formed in the community, which defines a lot of their life chances and their behaviours and their later access to the labour market, etc. To pension age and beyond, you know, because we've got an ageing population, you know, we're going to have to work on later in life. You know, a lot of us are going to not be too happy about that. A lot of people are going to want the opportunity to do that. And whenever we're considering any labour market problem or issue, we should be thinking about that wide spectrum of issues. And, you know, when you look at, for example, you know, the settled and established BME community, and in terms of their access to the labour market, there are issues. There's a lot of evidence around, for example, anonymised, applications compared to names that are manifestly black or ethnic compared to names that are manifestly white. And there's some research from the States, which has also been replicated in the UK, that shows that there's almost a 50% chance of not getting through to the selection stage after the initial CV submission stage if your name is manifestly black or ethnic. And that's an issue that we need to tackle. But, you know, that applies to people that are already in the system, and we've got to think about how we actually tackle those issues. And our belief in CIPD is that, you know, the issue of collecting data is absolutely, you know, paramount, but also the issue about behaviours and mindsets. And that's much more difficult. How do you change behaviours and mindsets? One of the issues is you need to put in front of people the issue that they must consider these issues, that they must think about their unconscious bias. And a colleague from STUC talked about that earlier. We've got a report called The Mind at Work, which looks at how you think about issues like, you know, just your worldview, your limited perception can affect how you make decisions. And that shows how difficult the issues are. And when you look within the actual ethnic minority groups themselves, one thing, economists love pay data because it's easy to collect. They don't really like issues or researching issues about characteristics and progression through the labour market. But if you look at the data, there's a really good report by Hilary Metcalf for the National Institute of Economic and Social Research, which is national research, but there's no reason to assume that Scotland would be any different, which shows the different pay outcomes for ethnic minorities. And it actually shows that within ethnic minorities themselves, and this is kind of folk wisdom that a lot of people think they know, but, you know, there's actually a higher rate than the average, which is the white male population in this sample. And there's also research on full-time and part-time work that shows that within the ethnic minority communities themselves, there's a lot of difference and differential in outcome. And we have to be clear about what problem we're trying to solve. But there's an absolute need for awareness raising and understanding that, you know, the fact that, you know, young people aren't getting the right level of access to MAs, that a lot of the established community aren't getting access to jobs, you know, and there are well-known evidence cases that show why that is, and that it's related to ethnicity, and this is statistically controlled and modelled, then, you know, we need to have a dialogue. And I think the issue is that, you know, it's easy to get into solution mode, but I think we need a dialogue before we start to get into solutions, because the solutions that we come up with might not be fit for the problem we're trying to solve.
Katie, do you want to say anything?
Okay. On the careers information, advice and guidance, you were asking about schools. So we developed guidance on the development. We've got partnerships agreements with schools about school-based career coaching. And this includes specific guidance on considering the needs of ethnic minority groups in particular. the individuals have face-to-face meetings with our careers coaches. That's a discussion between the school and, you know, to select pupils, etc. We've got an equality toolkit for our careers information, advice and guidance staff, and that includes how you sensitively handle day-to-day situations about customs, etc., and also the use of interpreters as well. We've also got continued professional development, online internet modules for our staff as well. And I think we've strengthened our partnership arrangements to better identify young people from BME backgrounds who are in a school setting too. The other thing that we're doing at the moment is we've got a research project with BME school pupils to ask them what they think about the CIEG services that they're receiving at the moment are, with a view to, are there any improvements that we could make with it too?
Are you aware then, is there any evidence around, are pupils from a ethnic minority backgrounds more or less likely to engage with the career service or to engage with it in a different way, or do they, is there any report of a different experience of the career service that you would maybe expect would reflect some of the other things that we know are going on in terms of a propensity to enter higher education for some groups, and then also the issues about, you know, worse labour market outcomes in the end. Is any of that borne out through the career services engagement?
I'm not personally aware of those things that go on, but I mean, I think if you're going into a higher education background, you're less likely to want, you know, intensive careers guidance support. And also I think there is evidence from wider uptake of employability services maybe in general about being less inclined to put yourself forward to DWP, etc., or our out of school services in terms of coming forward to seek employability support too.
Do you want to come in?
Yeah, I think there is some anecdotal evidence to suggest that schools reflect some of the stereotypical views of a career path. So, you know, well-meaningly so, I think teachers will sort of reflect back to students what a lot of, like, their parents are saying as well. So, like, they'll say to working class girls, oh yes, you should be a childcare worker, and they'll say to a working class boy, oh yes, you should be a bricklayer, and they'll say to an ethnic minority girl, oh yes, you should be a pharmacist, and they'll sort of reflect those stereotypes back. And I think it's about helping, you know, teachers to sort of remember that you don't necessarily have to do that, and you can encourage people to widen their horizons. And I think one of the nice things about the My World of Work website is that it is a website, and one of the hopes for that website was that it would give alternative pathways to similar places, so that it would help people understand the fact that they could take a vocational route rather than just an academic route, and it would help people think about what their options were without necessarily having that kind of prejudice of you look like this, or I know your mum, so I'm going to say this to you sort of a thing, which is what we really want to try and break down, because we don't want to pigeonhole people into certain routes. We want to give students the opportunity to choose their own paths.
John, do you want to come in?
Yeah, one of the issues, and I think it was quite a... It's a telling issue in schools that quite often when we think young people are destined for university, I think Katie was saying, I'm not saying this is evidence, you know, it's something that we all know in our social world. We hear it all the time. There isn't a careers conversation with a lot of young people that are destined, in inverted commas, for university. And that's part of the problem of parity of esteem, about how we actually have a really good dialogue with young people about what their options are and how people get baked into choices. And one of the pieces of research that we've recently carried out with SCOPE, which is the Centre for, you know, Operational and Labour Market Research at Oxford and Cardiff, is around overqualification. And, you know, there's a lot of overqualification in the labour market in the UK generally, and a lot of it is because, you know, people have effectively just been chosen or had options selected for them or pre-selected for them, end up in university without really the right skills that they possibly need for the careers that are available, and drift into, you know, jobs that don't actually use their full skills. And those are issues that are part of the problem as well for all communities.
I think I've got three witnesses wanting to come in. David, Katie, then Helen.
Yeah, and
just David and Katie.
I think that's part of... where schools are taking forward a wider view of work and the place of work within education. The careers education standards that are being launched are going to broaden out young people's understanding of work from an early age, and to engage with that about their understanding of the world of work and what it means to them. And so to begin to engage about that discussion about what a career should be and how what they should aspire for that. I think another bit of work that goes together with that is that we were asked within the Wood Commission to embed equality education across curriculum for excellence, and we're working to populate equality as content within the curriculum, to engage with gender stereotyping, to look at prejudice, to look at issues around migration and just how that can be part of a study within the curriculum, again from an early age. So we're looking to further improve the curricular content there.
Okay. When you reply, can you tell us what has currently been happening just now as well regarding careers, advice and information, Kate?
Okay, there's a blended service, that's what it is, and it's blended, and there's some targeted support for one-to-one support, but every pupil in Scotland, if they want one-to-one support, can get it. You know, the opportunity is still there. We offer some of it online, as mentioned by Helen, and we offer group sessions in schools. We've actually just been given money by Scottish Government to put it further down the school, so everybody will be take part in a group session much earlier in the school system than they currently do too. So it is a blended service. It's a blended service for two main reasons. It's about personal choice and the way that messages that you receive, you might receive them in a different way from other things, and also targeting support where it's needed most. And that's why you've got to do that in terms of your intensive support.
Okay, thank you. Drew? You okay?
Obviously, you can take these things back as far as you want to, but I mean, do Education Scotland, for example, collect evidence on or collect data on ethnic minority backgrounds of pupils and their subject choices through school, and how early does that start?
Yeah, I mean, that fed into it, the subject choices. I think from ethnic minorities are broadly similar to the general population. The biggest diversion in subject choices is between boys and girls.
Yeah.
But I'm not clear that the subject choices for ethnic minorities are differentiated than the national.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we're moving on to Christian now. Annabelle, yeah.
Mr. Watt, Education Scotland's inspection and review framework embraces 10 principles, one of which is equality and diversity. How does an inspector then discharge that responsibility in relation to the provision of careers advice in a school to a young person from an ethnic minority background? And although we are now aware a lot of advice is given in respect of career choices to young people at school, how many careers advisors come from an ethnic minority background themselves?
Well, I'll kindly ask my colleague to deal with the second part, but if I could pick up on the inspection process. The recently issued inspection advice notice, that's now the updated guidance for inspection for the coming school session, strongly threads through the developing the young workforce agenda. Talks around the career education standards, and the career education standards are framed in terms of their qualities. Initially, when the school self-evaluation is sought, we ask it how well do they promote diversity and equality and ensure inclusion, and that the answer they give us in that will enable us the inspection to talk with children and young people, parents and staff around that agenda they've set. So going into inspection in the coming session, I think we can expect a greater focus on DYW and a greater focus on equality education within that. Could I name you a report where ethnic minority careers advice was commented on by inspector? I'm not sure I could, but these discussions feature within inspection. It's the opportunity we on occasion pull together a group of ethnic minority children, ask them about their school experience, ask them about the support they receive. It more likely focus on the support they receive from their guidance staff and their support staff rather than their careers advice. But again, it would be a trail that we could engage with in a school.
Convener, I think that's very helpful, because my question is not to criticise Education Scotland. I think we're all agreed we're slightly, you know, swimming through strands of weed in the sea at the moment, trying to just see what the picture is. But it seems to me that with the best of intentions, the discharge of the equality and diversity obligation in the inspection and review framework may very naturally have concentrated on relations within the school amongst pupils and behaviour between pupils and staff to pupils. But this specific issue of how youngsters from an ethnic minority background obtain careers advice may be something off the radar screen. And if there was any more information you could give us about that, Mr. Watt, I think that would be helpful.
Well, the inspection advice note is worth having a look at. Aligned to that, we're doing some tryouts of new inspection models, and a couple of themes. The theme for the coming few months in the tryouts is the senior phase, and part of the senior phase is ensuring that that pathway is personalised and that you're well informed about what you need to be undertaken to have that experience that equips you for the next stage. There's opportunities for us there to engage with ethnic minorities in the schools that we are focusing our tryouts.
Katie, do you want to come in on that?
Sorry, I don't actually have the figure with me about the number of careers guidance, career coaches within SDS who are from an ethnic minority background. But the other thing I'd like to say about careers information and guidance, when I said it's a bit of a blended approach, it's also not just delivered by SDS, because it's delivered through partnerships in schools. So there's guidance teachers in schools. There's a variety of school professionals who spend far more time with the pupils than SDS staff can. So it's about providing a more blended approach. So there's a number of people involved in guiding young people in school. But we can get you the figures.
Good.
Yeah.
Sort of the issues around school. Is there any examples of work with parents? It's all very well to say, you know, what is the careers information and assistance people are getting at school, but if some of the pressure comes from family or home, is there, you know, is anyone doing anything to inform parents as much as possible about the options that might be available for their child and the things they might want to speak to them about?
Well, I mean, the good practice would be in and around the second and third year options, and usually that would be an evening where parents are together with guidance staff and SDS staff to talk through what the options are. I think we're now seeking to encourage business to and employers to be better engaged at those stages set out, particularly, you know, in some local communities. Again, we're looking for school staff, not just SDS staff, to be aware of the profile of employers and to have a better understanding of how their the teaching and learning that takes place in the classroom relates to the employment market out there that the young people are going to face. I think in terms, again, of parents, it would be more around availability, and I suppose that a challenge is to speak about a broader perspective on what the next stage might be.
Katie?
As well as what David's mentioned there about SDS staff in schools, My World of Work online service has got a specific section devoted to parents to provide the information that's required there. And also what I mentioned in terms of the work that BMIS are doing, a lot of that is actually targeted at both individuals but parents crucially too within the communities.
Okay, Christian.
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. And unfortunately, I'm going to ask more questions about surveys and data, and particularly the one we're collecting for people working. And that's quite important. So my first question will be about, we heard a lot early on about data and survey doing at school and doing at MAs and doing at higher education. And we're trying to compare them with data that you collect at work and surveys that we do at work. Is there discrepancies there with the number of people from a different ethnic background who have not been educated in Scotland? Will that explain a lot of the difference that we find?
Who would like to answer? Everybody's looking at you, Kate.
Sorry, could you repeat your question again? Because I'm not quite sure.
A lot of the data, we try to compare data and surveys that we do at school and in education with data and surveys on doing what we do at work for people at work. Now the problem is there's a lot of people who are working particularly on low wages, mm-hmm. are people who have not been educated in Scotland, who have come in the 20s or the 30s. Will that explain a lot of the difference that we find between the two set of data?
What do you mean about the two sets of data?
Yeah, because we're trying to compare, we're trying to explain why a lot of people from ethnic background having quite a very good education and quite successful during education, but when we come into as a 20, 30, 40 years old, we found there's a big difference about wages. So with part of the explanation will be that a lot of people from different ethnic backgrounds are in fact people who came into these countries after being educated somewhere else.
Helen.
I think what you're sort of hitting on here is that it is a very complex picture, and that the data sources that we're using are very limited to tell us things, and we're trying to sort of get that kind of picture, exactly what you're describing. But it's really difficult to do that because the labour market data that we use tends to get us no further than white or non-white, really, in Scotland, and is quite thin on the ground an awful lot of the time. So we have to use our understanding from wider sources than just pure statistics. So we know that there is a difference between whether or not you're raised and go through the Scottish education system and whether or not you're a new migrant. We know that there's a difference. I think what we've been talking about currently on the committee has been people coming through the education system. And there suggests that people coming through the education system from, you know, leavers, survey, destination surveys from education, there suggests that there are less good outcomes for that group as a group. But then you get into a wider picture as well of labour market disadvantage when you look at what's happening to new entrants to the labour market as well. So there are two different issues going on that perhaps are related. We know that people who are new entrants to the country are generally working in very certain sectors because they're coming in on tier two shortage visas. So they'll be in the health service. They'll be working at Rosyth on the nukes, being nuclear engineers. They'll be, you know, in our education service in particular areas, particularly further and higher education. And we can identify within those public sector employers problems with progression within employment. So yes, people are employed, but they aren't necessarily rising through the ranks and that's a very identifiable trend. But it's identifiable primarily for people who are new entrants. But then you get other issues that are caught up. It's harder to track what's happening to the domestic population, obviously, because they're much more spread out through the sectors. But there does suggest like there is a problem there as well. It's hard to know, though.
So if it's harder to track, maybe it'd be better for us to concentrate really on what's happening at work and what the challenges are at work, as opposed to try to compare two things which are difficult to compare.
We would agree that there has to be an absolute focus on what's happening in public sector employment in Scotland. I think it is unforgivable that we can see a very identifiable trend within the health service, for example, that ethnic minority nurses are congregated in the very bottom grade and they feel that they cannot get out of that grade. And I think the work at NHS Lothian, which for years and years the STUC was hearing a lot of complaints from ethnic minority staff at NHS Lothian through our sort of informal network, works. And now they are running this really great programme that's very well put together about supporting NHS, ethnic minority NHS nurses to rise through the ranks. And they're already within year one seeing people being promoted off the back of it. And it's a very well put together programme, but it's quite easily replicated in other places. So I think there is definitely stuff that we can do. And perhaps if we focus on what is in our gift and what's fixable, that is a good start.
John?
I suppose there's, when you look at labour market access, the key issues which you can't disentangle from any other outcome are skills and qualifications, yeah? And when we take them out and when we control for them and we see ethnic bias, then that gives us a public policy and labour market problem that we have to address. But we have to be clear, you know, what those issues are. And a lot of them will relate to skills. I mean, not just qualifications, it's about recognition from different jurisdictions, etc., and how qualifications are rated. And Scotland's got an excellent qualifications recognition system through SQA and SQCF that can help to address that. But it's also about skills, and I suppose one of the biggest skills around language skills, around the kind of cognitive skills that are needed in key areas. And anybody who's tried to recruit recently knows that, you know, the recruitment environment is becoming more and more complex. The skills that are required for roles are more and more multidimensional. And sometimes, you know, with the best will in the world, you know, people who have got, you know, fairly difficult to predict qualifications going into that kind of job selection pool won't stand a chance unless we take some other action. But that action needs to be based on evidence. And I'd be interested in the Lothian programme in terms of, you know, the data for that, that shows that there is a different outcome for BME nurses, that was actually, that's a big public sector organisation that can collect that data and can model it. And can maybe give an example to the private sector, the bigger organisations like banks, etc., to see how they can compare. But that's the dialogue part that we need to get into before we start to define solutions, as I said earlier, because a lot of those issues are around qualifications and skills.
Okay, thank you. Chris?
That's quite interesting what you just said about languages, and Ellen Martin as well, when you talk about, you know, less concentrate on what we know. And languages is something, you know, languages could be a big barrier. I know that in an office, if you don't speak the Doric, you'll have some trouble. But it's maybe that maybe we should concentrate on is trying to work on data which is easy to define. A bit like the gender balance. The gender balance is easy because it's you get a true picture. When it's more difficult to get a true picture when you talk about ethnicity. But if you start to talk about barriers regarding languages, or when you talk about barriers regarding employment, sustainable employment with the category of people that we know about, it's a lot easier. So restricting, that will maybe be the answer. I would like to have some views about that.
Helen?
Yeah. I think it is important to be prepared to look at what we know and to be prepared to tackle the problems where we see them quite obviously existing. I would be a little bit reticent to say that we can just disregard things that are difficult to measure, because in the area of ethnicity in Scotland, things are going to be difficult to measure. They just are, you know, because the numbers are quite low. The surveys aren't very well designed for our purposes, particularly big national surveys. So we kind of have to accept the fact that we are always going to be in the dark a little bit. But that doesn't mean that we don't have information. It doesn't mean that we don't know things. It might just not be statistical information, but we can take evidence from community groups. We can ask people what their experience of the labour market is, and we can take that evidence seriously, even though it's not necessarily backed up by a statistic. There is other ways to collect evidence, and I think it would be important that we do have, you know, a focus on community dialogue and actually taking seriously the problems that people identify, because, you know, that's what we try to do through our Black Workers Network, and that's how we knew that there was a problem at NHS Lothian 10 years ago, before there was ever a statistic about how the nurses were congregated in the bottom grade. We knew that there was a problem, and then James Glover came in and collected the data, and everybody now knows there's a problem. But we could have done it 10 years ago off the back of what the nurses were saying.
if we wanted to.
I read your evidence about it, but are you suggesting we should use anecdotal, data just to, we really need proper evidence to make proper change or to invest or to use resources? Anecdotal evidence, is it enough?
In my view, if you have tried to collect the data over many, many years, which we have in Scotland, there has been a lot of emphasis on that. I've worked around ethnicity now for a decade, and we have this conversation every year. And every year we talk about how difficult it is to collect the data. And at some point, you have to accept if that question is fixable or not. If it's fixable, fix it. If it's not fixable, then let's use the information that we have to do something. But we can't just sit here trying to create better statistics every, because that's not helping anybody.
On my last question, I'm going to ask the other members and try to help you, Helen Martin, about that. The challenge is that ethnicity is getting a lot more complicated in the world today. My mother happened to be Portuguese, my wife was Scottish, what are my children? And a lot of more families are being this now, being that different kind of people with different background. Maybe Helen Martin is right, and I would like to challenge the few views on this. Should we stop trying to collect data and trying to make it so precise when we have no chance in hell to win that battle because the complexity of our population is getting such that it's impossible?
Who would like to answer? Katie?
I think, like Helen, I think you look at both sides of it. You look at what data you can collect and what you can actually, that you think is trustworthy, but also I think you do speak to communities, get the dialogue going. I think that's part of the stuff that you do around, does this work for you? How could it be improved? The sort of stuff you do around continuous improvement, but also about identifying if there are serious issues somewhere with some community, some locality. So I think a bit of both, to be honest.
Okay, very briefly, John, to move on to the next question.
Yeah, sure. I think just even if you're only dealing with populations of people that you've identified, you've still got to collect data. You've got a group of people there. You can get the information on their qualifications, on their skills, and you can use that as a basis. And that's where we have to go. We have to drill down into specific contexts.
Okay, if we've got time, we can come back to that after, but we're actually quite tight for time, so I need to move on to John Finney. If you've got any questions, John.
Thank you, Convener. I have a couple which I'll direct to Dr. McGurk, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to use the D word as well, because I had a couple of questions around that. You expressed the view that it's paramount, and I think we would all accept that, and we'd want... You're perhaps in a unique position of your members will be both in the public, private sector, widely spread. Do these employers understand why it's important, Dr. McGurk?
Yeah, I think there's variability amongst employers. I think public sector employers, given the leadership that's been provided by various administrations in the Scottish Government and the UK Government as well, are aware of the issues. I think a lot of private sector employers, large SMEs, they're in a global talent, MNCs, multinational corporations, they're in a global talent market. Their customers are diverse. Their market is diverse. They need to be operating a policy of diversity and, the issue of inclusiveness in the labour market is a business issue increasingly. And it should be, because it's about people being able to make their contribution to the labour market without any barriers to them being able to do that. And it's about employers getting access to the best talent that they can access and develop. So there's definitely variability in understanding. The real problem is in the smaller and medium-sized enterprises. That's just because of visibility of the issue, and that's something that we can all do more. And I know that STUC and Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Enterprise, have these debates. The trouble is we're having such a multiplicity of discussions around virtually everything, which is great. It shows the amount of energy there is for change, that sometimes things get lost and we've got to put it more to the top of the agenda.
Can I ask about a very specific aspect? Uh-huh. You referred to it as organisational exit interviews.
Sure. Uh-huh.
I did pose a question to Police Scotland about that, uh-huh. and the particular challenge that a number of people who would leave an organisation, the last thing they would want to do is sit in a room with the people perhaps who they felt had been course to them and explain that. Is there an opportunity to learn from, I mean, obviously there's an opportunity to learn from exit interviews. Can you give us any examples, particularly with regard to race, where an exit interview has resulted in perhaps a change in work practices in that or a change in approach? Because there's clearly a glorious opportunity there.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not aware of any specific examples, but we have a lot of research in CIPD, and if we can, you know, find any of that research, we'll put it your way. The issue about exit interviews is, you know, do people want to engage with the organisation at that stage? What's their frame of mind? You know, what are they going to actually disclose? Is there an issue about that? If there is proper monitoring, and that's a big if, you know, if we were finding that there was a disproportionately large number of people from a particular group exiting an organisation, we should investigate that, and we should interview them in a more neutral environment, for example, and get an idea. And that would be another piece of data that we could use to address the issue.
And accepting the challenges, and again the small numbers, is an organisation like yourself in a position, perhaps even through informal discussions, to understand that there might be a pattern developing? Just, yeah, you know, whilst mm-hmm. individuals, the wider might suggest that.
Yeah, I mean, the HR professionals that we represent that work in business and in the public sector will certainly be aware to different degrees, but I would say in a large public sector body like Police Scotland or, you know, the NHS, then they should be collecting that data. It might be very, you know, limited data, but, you know, I think that if there was a disproportionate incidence of people from a particular group leaving an organisation, it would ring alarm bells. I'm not saying that in all cases the individuals would challenge that, but it definitely should, and it should be something that they would be talking about across their networks. How we would capture that, I don't know.
John, I think Helen wants to come in on mm-hmm. this as well before you move on. Do you? Yeah.
Sorry, yeah. I would quite like to, but I don't want to cut across the conversation. what John is saying is correct, but at the same time, I think we shouldn't be too keen to accept that employers will just pick this stuff up. I think it does require quite a lot of dedicated action on the part of the employer. Like, the employer has to go in with an eye to looking at how their ethnic minority staff are finding their workplace, how that workplace outcomes are looking for ethnic minority staff, because you would be amazed how long a trend can exist within an organisation and the employer not really see it until it's kind of pointed out to them and they're looking at it in quite a systematic way. And as trade unionists, we try to do this in a whole range of ways, equal pay being quite an obvious one. You know, it takes quite a lot of dedicated effort to go through all your structures and work out what's happening. For ethnic minority staff, we find that access to training can be a really big barrier. Often it can be simply the fact that people are clustered in grades where training isn't routinely offered, and that might mean that ethnic minority staff might never get access. It's not deliberately targeted at preventing them from getting access. It just happens that way because that's the way the company is structured. So stuff like that can be broken down quite easily, but you have to realise that it's happening, and you have to have a look at how the organisation has been structured.
Okay, thank you. If I may, it's precisely that point, thank you, Helen, that I was going to pick up on, that to say you can have, of course, formal structures about exit interviews and all the rest, but as Ms Martin says, I would hope there'd be some form of monitoring nonetheless, and particularly a focus on minority groups within the workforce. Is that likely to be the case, Dr McGurk?
I think it's likely to be the case in large public sector bodies, but the issue is how do individuals actually disclose that information, and that's really something that's around the overall governance structures of those industries. Well, government has got obviously a big say in how those industries actually operate, but generally HR professionals should be on the lookout for that kind of thing. I'm not saying they would always take action in all circumstances, but, you know, it's another part of the dialogue that we have to be more systematic about. If that's an issue, we have to identify it, and we have to have a way of getting it out in the open and getting it discussed. But the evidence that you presented will help us to do that.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to John Mason now.
Yeah,
Thanks, Convener. And perhaps to move in a slightly different area, kind of employment barriers and that kind of thing. And Dr. McGurk, you already mentioned the fact that sometimes by people looking at the names on an application form can have an impact. And we have heard evidence that ethnic minority job applicants are less likely than others to get past shortlisting and interviews and so on. Is there anything we can do to tackle that side of things?
I think one of the first issues is that, you know, we in the HR community generally have to have a dialogue about it. You know, we have to, you know, put it in terms of having a dialogue about it, getting data to show where it exists and where the issues are, and then developing professionals to be able to counteract it. You know, so for example, in the recruitment phase and that evidence from, I think it was something like, are Greg and Emma more likely to be shortlisted than Letitia and Jamal? Yeah, so these were quite evidently white American type names. The same study was replicated in the UK by two of my former colleagues at Cardiff Business School, Mike Noonan and Kim Hawk. And you know, and it basically came to the same conclusion. And the issue that it raises is that you know, the screening process should be, you know, generally the CVs, for example, as a method of submission should be discouraged. You know, a CV is often sent for high-level roles because you want to have a real drill down into people's skills and qualifications and career history. You should be able to do that on a standard application form. That should be standardised. It should have all of the monitoring information on it. Does that happen all the time? No, it doesn't.
So would you leave the name off the application form?
You could do. What I would say is there are lots of areas that we can consider, but, you know, before we actually make recommendations and decisions about this, we have to have a dialogue about what actually works in different circumstances. And what doesn't.
Are you aware of any employers where they have tried something like that and it has worked?
Yeah. Yes. BT, for example, have had anonymous submissions. And the trouble is that when people have done this, they haven't always had a control group to actually compare it against to see that it's improved practice. They've just brought in the practice. So it's part of a general issue around resourcing and talent planning, which is the professional area that's responsible for recruitment and development of staff. That we actually start to look at these issues and how they actually operate and collect much more evidence. And this inquiry has made us aware that we need to do more of that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've had a whole lot of submissions, but one of the comments, I think it was Western Bartonshire, referred to a report from the Coalition for Race, Equality and Rights, suggesting that, you know, when it gets to interview, we put too much emphasis on experience and not enough on competence.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if that's something you would agree with. And I'm not sure how you actually split this up, because if I want somebody in my office who's going to get on well with people, well, if they haven't had any experience of getting on well with people, I don't know how I measure that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's I'm sure every, you know, all of the witnesses will have a different view of this. My view, and I was a former learning and talent development lead advisor in CIPD nationally, and, you know, I dealt a lot with the issue. There are certain people who think that competence-based assessment is the be-all and end-all. There are other people that think that the world is changing and more fluid and dynamic, and that competence kind of bakes in a certain type of behaviour and skill. But obviously it has to be a mix of the two. And how you do that is by having properly structured interviews. And you do sometimes have to consider things like CVs, because they give you more of the experience issue. You have to conduct, I would say, telephone screening interviews with very targeted questions that ask people about their skills and their capability. You have to actually, you know, conduct structured interviews with questions and with rankings for the candidate, so that you're asking them the same questions and you're assessing them on the same criteria.
Which is all very well for BT and Lothian Council and all these people, but, sorry, Edinburgh Council, you know, most employers are just quite small. I mean,
absolutely.
How on earth can we make an impact there?
Yeah, it's a really good point, and I think being small doesn't mean that you shouldn't be fair. You know, it's all about viability, visibility, the issue, and viability of the practice. So from our point of view, our people skills project, which we're developing, a lot of the evidence will be, a lot of the support will be around recruitment. So we'll certainly be putting in good practice guidelines, which will be based on our based on our fact sheets on fair recruitment, for example, and selection, that will help SMEs to actually think about these issues. Because I don't think there are very few people out there who are going to say, I don't want to employ a person from a BME community. You know, but you know, sometimes through unconscious bias, through lack of visibility in that community, in that in contrast to the audibility of the bottles being there, dispatched there, that in itself is something that, you know, making people aware and making it viable for them to do it. So if we put big processes in front of them that make it difficult, that make them have to comply in a tick box way, they'll get routine about it and they won't do it mindfully. Mm-hmm. We want them to do it mindfully in a committed way because it's the right thing to do.
Okay, I wonder if any of the other witnesses want to comment on that kind of area at all, Ms. Martin?
I think I just I'd agree with that final point. I think it is about people just considering the issue for a minute, because evidence, we have research evidence that shows that where people are asked to do it in a fair way, that that actually does help the outcome. Yeah. It can be as simple as that, actually. And there is no right or wrong way to recruit when it comes to this issue, because the issue isn't so much the process that people are engaging with, it's the person that they're engaging with, you know, it's the subjectivity that's involved within the process. And people will make a decision about who's the best person for their organisation, and they won't necessarily realise that they're picking somebody because they look like them or they seem like them, but they will. And if you can interrupt that thought process, then you can make a real difference. And that's sort of part of the learning that we've seen already through the project, like at NHS Lothian. That was kind of part of it, was that sort of training on unconscious bias and trying to make sure that recruiters actually just considered fairness in their actions.
Okay, anybody else want to comment?
No. Okay, I mean, kind of moving on from that then, maybe less at the recruitment process, but as somebody tries to move on in an organisation, the kind of informal networks and things can become very important. And, well, one example, seeing we're hearing all these bottles, I mean, you know, people go to the pub, they socialise in the pub, that excludes perhaps Muslim folk or anybody else that's not happy with the alcohol side of things. Is that a problem? And again, can we do much about that?
Anybody want to answer that? Helen, and then David, do you want to answer as well? Okay, we'll go for David first. He's not spoke for a while.
Well, I'm usually not this shy. I'm not sure that from an education point of view in terms of organisation across Scotland, it's something to offer. But if we look at, we'd mentioned earlier, thin slice judgment, as a piece of psychology, that you go into a job interview and in almost all cases it's decided within the first 5 seconds. Yeah. There's clear evidence that's what takes place, and just asking somebody about fairness would dissipate that. From the education angle, it's who you are that makes a difference these days, not what school you go to, and therefore the networking bit comes in, because that's about your identity. So you network with who you know, and if you don't have those networks, then that's going to disadvantage you to engage in employment. I mean, that's just an observation from that side of things.
Okay. Helen?
Yeah, I think the specific example that you raised is a real problem. It is an issue within workforces, that people feel like it is about who you're friends with. It can be, you know, cultural practices can really hold people back within the workforce. But I think it doesn't have to be that way. You know, a very small amount of emphasis on this within employers can really break down barriers quite a lot. Even just having training courses that allow people to come together and discuss the issue can be actually really, really helpful, because it just clears the air and it just gets preconceptions out of the way. The STC has been running over the last couple of years a Scottish Union Learning course for BME workers on moving into management. And a lot of that, the success, that course has actually been really successful, and it has helped people move into promoted posts, even though it's had no contact with employers at all. It's all been focused on the employee, and it's been taking people from a whole mixture of workplaces from all across Scotland. But what that really looked at was about coping. It was about resilience, essentially. It was about coping with racism and providing people networks amongst themselves, really, to give peer-to-peer support going forward. And just having that kind of solidarity and that ability to discuss things has, the feedback is phenomenal. People are saying that it's transformed their whole way that they look at their career. And as a result, they become more positive about themselves and their skills, and the employer picks up on that. So even, you know, small behavioural changes from both the employee and the employer can have a really quite a dramatic impact on the outcomes for people.
I mean, I like that, and I'd like to go down that route, but I mean, I just wonder if that's just going to take forever while we change people's attitudes. I mean, with women and men, you know, I think there was the feeling, well, we just gradually encourage, but I mean, the progress has been so minimal, certainly in the political field, that eventually people have just started saying, right, we are going to have 50-50 or 40-60 or whatever on a company board, in the cabinet, these kind of things. I mean, we have had a suggestion from, is it Amina, the Muslim Women's Resource Centre, that we should be looking at quotas, and that is really the only way to make something happen. Is that something you think is useful?
Okay, you're talking about in terms of modern apprenticeships for.
Well,
for
it certainly BMA. Could be modern apprenticeships, but. Mm-hmm.
One of the issues of that, we offer a funding contribution towards the training and assessment costs, but it's the employer that employs the individual. So in terms of introducing a quota, that could be problematic, I think.
But if every one of your modern apprenticeships mm-hmm. was white next year, and male uh-huh. for that matter, you know, you would find that unacceptable. So the question is how.
Well, I think a lot of what we're doing in terms of the projects that I've described earlier today is about trying to change minds and influence individuals against cultural pathways that there are in terms of what happens post 16, and you've got to understand that in terms of the context that we're working in. You get into all sorts of legal things around quotas too in terms of what you're offering. So, I mean, I wouldn't want to jump into anything without those kind of things being thought through.
Mm-hmm. Can I come in that? Do you think it's mainly there's two areas that really should take priority here? Is one, the young people in school prior to leaving to choose their career options, and also target the employers as well? Because as you say, it's employers that actually employ the individuals and then choose to do the modern apprenticeship. So it looks as if it's like a two-strand attack you actually need to do. Would you agree with that? Is that right?
I think there's actually
three strands. Mm-hmm. 28% of people in Scotland think it's okay to hold a prejudice. 66% of them think more should be done to challenge prejudice. Mm-hmm. So we've got a gap to narrow there, and that mm-hmm. comes out of the social attitude survey, and that asks some questions to people of who would you employ, you know, and those from a gypsy traveller background or transgender have got no chance mm-hmm. in terms of the percentages that people just admit to in a survey. So I think we broadly need to be not just an inclusive identity in Scotland, but put that into practice. Again, I think we have that 66% is a more than solid basis for that. And I think there's something in how do we empower diverse communities, that people have to make their way in the broad stream of society, but how do we pull them together in small groups to support each other? Mm-hmm. I think there's something in that going across the identity bits. We had a very successful Deaf Learners Conference, 66 young people coming together for the first time, and they gained out of that mm-hmm. in looking at their agenda and the challenges they face. So I think opportunities to pull that together. Other people are better placed to comment on the role of employers, but we're looking to establish school employment partnerships that are effective. And again, in the best practice, they work really well with schools.
Okay. Helen, do you want to say it very briefly? Because I've still got another... committee member to ask questions.
Just very briefly, I think the problem with quotas, we would be in favour of quotas, but they're not really legal is the problem. But the only area where we think you should consider is potentially on foundation apprenticeships, because there is no employed status there, so you could potentially run quotas in that area, and you maybe should.
Okay. If the individual does not want to take part in it, then you, yes, you know that, that it's also it's supply and demand, I think, has got to work here too.
Anyway, can we sort of stop? Sorry, we need to sort of probably move on. John, are you finished?
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah.
Can we move on to Annabelle, please?
Yeah, I think I'm left with a kind of hybrid situation where about 4/5 of the question I was going to ask have been answered. And I think we'd all agree that coming from you this morning as witnesses has been some very positive information and some very encouraging information about what is happening, which is good. I mean, the one thing that is legal is positive action at the moment. And I was quite interested, Helen, in what you were saying about an unacceptable situation in a health board. And then when that's brought to the health board's attention and the health board is told, this is just unacceptable, immediately a process and procedure is introduced, which from what you were saying seems to have transformed the situation. So is it the case that limiting the use of positive action in the public sector is perhaps ignorance of what is happening or can be done? And how would we improve the situation in the public sector for assisting people from an ethnic minority background, either to get a job in the first place or to get proper career progression once in that job?
I think that's absolutely right. I think there needs to be a focus on it. And I think, as is the case with public policy in every area, like things go in and out of fashion, and it's been a few years before since we've really had a proper focus on race issues in a systematic way across Scotland. And I think public sector employers having a look at their own workforce, looking at where people are clustered, looking at their access to training, looking at promotion issues, and listening to communities, having a proper discussion with communities and hearing what they have to say about their own lives, I think that would be really, really helpful. And we could do a lot without necessarily having to change the law.
And does anyone else want to chip in to that question?
Yeah, I think the issue about positive action is that, you know, it's absolutely to be encouraged that we engage positively with different communities, that we build a diverse workforce. The issue is that, you know, characteristics are multifaceted. You know, you've got, you could have white working class kids from North Ayrshire could rightly consider themselves excluded from the labour market in Edinburgh. You know, you've got to think about how that is coherently and positively managed, and that it actually doesn't have the opposite effect, which is sometimes to cause another form of exclusion or perceived exclusion to another group. That's about, you know, government playing its role in absolutely doing what it can, the levers it can pull. It's about the private sector, the big private sector organisations that you know, like BT and RBS, etc., doing what they can to engage with diverse communities. And as long as the visibility of the issue is at the forefront, and the viability of it for smaller organisations is also possible, then I think we can make a lot of progress. But certainly the issue of positive action, for example, which has been practiced in lots of industries around, you know, we had an initiative in the airline industry around positive action. The fact that if you go to Southall or, Hounslow in West London, you see lots of people from BME communities, primarily South Asian, loading baggage onto airliners. And my PhD was in the labour market, the airline industry, and one of the issues that we looked at was, you know, how were these people getting into the better jobs in the airline industry? Like, for example, pilots. And I worked for the Airline Pilots Union for 8 years as the director of research, and we looked at doing that. And we did get a lot more applications. What we found out, though, and this is part of the issue with positive action, is that people get into a mentality where if we can recruit, then that's fine, we've fulfilled that. What we got were another layer of middle class young people who had STEM qualifications, who might have gone on and done other things, And a lot of the people that were still loading the baggage were still loading the baggage. So, you know, there's an issue about how what the outcomes are and how other people perceive that. But, you know, I'm not ruling it out. It's certainly something that should be considered if we don't make very strong progress in the coming years.
So just to summarise, convener, because I don't want to repeat ground we've gone over, are the four of you saying that with a combination of continuing to collect meaningful data to understand what's not happening, by continuing to look at areas of good practice, such as Helen described, by continuing, as John has just described, to look at what really is working in the private sector, and also taking note of David's important point about an underlying cultural issue, which is a broad one for Political and Civic Scotland to address, that if we can really move forward on these fronts, you can see a way towards improvement?
I can. I think, if, especially in Scotland, if we work together on this, I think we can make a big difference.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Do any members have any other questions they'd like to ask briefly just now? No? Any witnesses want to say anything they want to add they've not had the opportunity to? No?
The committee for addressing this really important issue at a very timely moment.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank you all for coming along and giving us the information and evidence today. It's been a really good session. We really appreciate it. And that concludes today's meeting. Our next meeting will take place on the 24th of September. And I now close the meeting. Thank you. Thank you.